the last game.
You win it all, or you go back home with nothing.
This is SportsCenter.
The San Antonio Spurs have taken a 2-0 lead in the NBA Finals.
He gets Ben a reverse jam! This place is going crazy!
Oh, there's an open for three! Oh, unbelievable!
This guy is off the charts!
One game for everything.
The San Antonio Spurs have won their third NBA World Championship!
The old adage proves true once again. Defense wins championships. Points at a premium in San Antonio, where for the third time in 7 years, they are the kings of the NBA. And Tim Duncan once again has his hands on some pretty hardware. We get the rock down to San Antonio and Stuart Scott.
Van Pelt, thanks a lot. Welcome back to SportsCenter's coverage of the NBA Finals, the first Game 7 in 11 years. Stuart Scott, Tim Legler, Greg Anthony. The Detroit Pistons were trying to give the Spurs something the Spurs hadn't had all year. Consecutive losses at home. Here we go. Game 7. Spurs have history on their side. The home team has won 81% of Game 7s in NBA history. But the Pistons, them kids ain't scared. Winners of 5 straight games when facing elimination. Larry Brown, Greg Popovich. Both admit beating each other is tough emotionally. First quarter, tied early. Ben Wallace. The defensive player of the year went 6 of 7 shooting in the first half. Pistons up 2 later in the first. Greg, man, looking for a 6th ring gives a guy incentive, doesn't it?
It does give him incentive. And thankfully for the San Antonio Spurs, Big Shot Bob showed up because he did it tonight.
Robert Horry gives the Spurs an 18-16 lead after 1. Second quarter, Spurs down 2. Tim Duncan drops a floater right in Antonio McDice's grill. Some newspaper writers had called Duncan Timid Tim. I asked him how that affected him. He said, I don't watch much TV or read the papers. Later in the second, Big Ben begins to take over. Watch it. Defenders leave him open. Wallace freaks him with the monster funk. Pistons up 1. Moments later, what legs? They didn't learn?
I guess not. And Antonio McDice here looking like Magic Johnson making plays for people. Ben Wallace understands what to do. When your man leaves, you run right to the front of the rim.
That tied it at 33. Next possession from the Department of Redundancy Department. Wallace again. 12 points in the first half. Pistons up 1 at recess. Third quarter, Pistons looking to take control. Up 3 and on the break, Tayshaun Prince getting some bunnies with a badouka dunk. Prince, though, the only starter for the Pistons in single digits. Pistons up 5, later 3rd. Spurs down 7. Tim Duncan got righteous. 5 of his 11 rebounds offensive. Spurs down 4. Still in the 3rd. Duncan again. Give me that and give me the foul. 10 of 27 shooting. More 3rd, more Duncan. Timmy, cut it out. Greg, what can you do to stop him?
Well, you really can't do anything. Once he gets into a rhythm and a flow, especially when they were undermanned Detroit with the foul trouble, Tim Duncan just took over.
He had 12 points in the 3rd quarter, but closing seconds, Lindsey Hunter, deep 2, tied at 57 after 3. 4th quarter, Duncan is on the roll. Buffs it. 105 career playoff games, 83rd career playoff game, double-double. Later 4th.
Oh, my saucy goodness. I didn't think he could dunk
right now.
Manu was saucy. Just over 8 bless minutes you, left. Robert Horry. Booyah. 54 career three-pointers in the finals for Horry. Most ever. Just over 6 minutes to go.
Spurs up 3. I had to save this for Bruce Bowen.
Buckets. Buckets. Spurs had 7 threes. Pistons only 2. Moments later, Spurs up 6. Rasheed Wallace. Floater. He had 11. Pistons down 4. Just over 3.5 legs. What's it say about Duncan that he came through when it counted?
I mean, he answered a lot of critics. People say, call this guy soft, timid, say he doesn't have the will to win. He's going to disappear when it matters. That's not what happened tonight. This guy demanded the basketball when it matters most, made his teammates better, drew so much attention. Guys like Manu could step up and put the dagger in.
That gave the Spurs a 72-65 lead. Chauncey Billups had a great series, but a huge block. He gets blocked there by Bruce Bowen. And then Manu Ginobili has cool as the other side of the pillow. Duncan and Ginobili, 33 of the Spurs, 43 points in the second half. The San Antonio Spurs win their 3rd NBA title. Robert Horry joins John Sally as the only NBA players to win championships with 3 different teams. You saw the coaches hugging each other, their best friends. Tim Duncan, the MVP, another championship trophy. His 3rd MVP finals and 3rd championship trophy. Final score, 81-74. Robert Horry, his 6th NBA championship. Either Robert Horry or Steve Kerr have been members of 11 of the last 12 NBA champions. After the game, everybody talking about the great series.
We didn't do anything special that we hadn't done in the first six games. We stuck to it. We believed in what we were doing, and we believed that if we did it the right way, we could get it done.
I won two with Dream, I won three with Shaq. Now, if he win it for me next year, then we can talk.
party, candy, I'm hyper, I'm energetic. This is a beautiful moment.
I'm as proud of my team today as I was, you know, June 16th last year.
Need to thank Coach Brown, because without him, I wouldn't even be sitting here. And I'd also like to congratulate our organization from top to bottom.
We play basketball to the last possible day that anybody can play basketball. You know, so probably right now you just want to get away.
Tim Duncan, when it comes to clinching games in the NBA Finals, has been straight ridiculous. This year he had 25 points in Game 7. Against the Nets a couple of years ago, 21. And against Lennox in back in 99, 31 points. Greg Anthony, what is it about this guy that is so, so underrated?
Well, I don't know how you could ever underrate a guy who has won three MVP finals awards. I mean, I think it started with his aggressive nature. He came out and set the tone. He got the Detroit Pistons' entire front line in foul trouble by himself. And ultimately, I think that really was what led to their demise, because then you're talking about trying to guard this guy with Tayshaun Prince. It is not going to happen. He's able to get too good a post position and pretty much score at will. And even if he couldn't make the shots, he was able to get his own offensive rebound. That set the tone. You saw the frustration on Rasheed Wallace's face. That was the difference in the game.
Well, I thought the turning point in this game is Rasheed Wallace went to the bench. Tim Duncan took over this game in the third quarter. They were down 9, and he demanded the basketball every time down the floor. And the guards, for one of the few times in this series, you see right there, Brent Barry delivering the ball exactly when he needed it to finish the play. He was decisive. He was strong. And you know what? That makes your role players confident. When your best player is playing well, now you can step up and make plays. Tim Duncan tonight showed you why he is one of the greatest players ever to play this game.
Tim Duncan first half, Tim Duncan second half. Struggled a bit in the first half. He shot 4 of 9, but he was still 8 points. For a guy who's supposed to lead his team, he had to come out in the second half. He had to put up big numbers, and as you see, 17 points in the second half. And he hit his free throws after the debacle that he had earlier in the series. Tim Duncan hit his free throws. After the game, Larry Brown gave Tim Duncan a whole lot of props. Larry Brown is already in the Hall of Fame. He's already the only coach ever to win an NBA championship and an NCAA championship. But whether or not he'll coach next year has been the topic of a lot of discussion. It all depends on his health. And after the game, the man they call LB talked about the possibilities.
Come on, let's talk about the game. That's the most important thing. I hope I'll be back coaching. That's been my plan, if Joe wants me, if I'm able to do it. But, you know, they just won a championship.
Larry Brown, he is the third coach ever with 100 career postseason coaching wins. He achieved that when they won Game 6. Phil Jackson, Pat Riley, a lot of people say he's the best teacher ever in the NBA. What does this guy mean for the entire game?
A lot, because I think this is a guy that shows you what you can get when you maximize your entire roster. This guy had a versatile team, but Larry Brown did a phenomenal job of putting all of these guys in the right positions to succeed on the floor. And I tell you what, if he doesn't come back, somebody's going to inherit a heck of a team.
A great team, but really he's the guy that took this team to the next level. Remember, Rick Carlisle had a similar basketball team, but they were not nearly as effective. Now, granted, it helps to get a Rasheed Wallace, but he's the guy who was able to integrate Rasheed into that roster and still develop the chemistry, allowed him to win a championship and then get to a Game 7 in the second.
Larry Brown's all class, and it's reflected by everyone who's around him. His kids told him when the series first started, hey, Dad, because Greg is such a good friend of yours, Greg Popovich, even if the Spurs win, it's still a win-win situation. They remember the Alamo in San Antonio, but they remember a team that's won 3 NBA titles in the last 7 years. From San Antonio, back to the man we call Van Peasy in the studio. Scott?
Stuart, thanks so much. With Steve Rathume, I am Scott Van Pelt. So much more to come on SportsCenter from San Antonio, where the Spurs have grabbed the jewelry once again.
When SportsCenter continues, the important baseball action from around the major leagues, as well as Omaha, coming up inside SportsCenter. It's been a rough season for the 24, but will it be a lost season for Jeff Gordon? What he can do to get back in the Nextel Cup chase, coming up. Derek Lee tearing it up. Why Lee's chances at a triple crown are looking a whole lot better. He's the new Mr. Cup. Plus, Annika's pursuit of the Soren Slam. Her usual nerves of steel. A little rocky on day one at the U.S. Women's Open in Cherry Hills. And we head back to San Antonio. We've seen the game. Now it's time for the celebration. World champs again down in San Antonio. More Sports Center after this.
Player ever to win an NBA Finals MVP three times. Tim Duncan, you said before the game that you were nervous. 25 points, 11 boards. Why didn't it show?
Oh, it was there. I've been nervous for 4 days now. It's the entire thing was nervous. The most nervous I've ever been having to do anything with basketball, and it was kind of a weird feeling, but it was a great feeling, great to end it out this way.
Why was it nervous this time? You've played in NBA Finals games before. Why now?
I have no idea. I don't know. I'm getting old. My nerves are getting bad.
There were some writers who started calling you Timid Tim in the newspaper, more than one. What does it make you feel when you read it or hear about it?
This is the first I'm hearing about it. And
no one ever said anything. You didn't even hear it.
No, I don't read or watch TV a whole lot, or especially around this time. I try not to. Try to stay away from it. But you know what? I'm me. I'm gonna be as the best I can on the floor. I didn't have the greatest series, but when it came down to it, I just continued to push and continued to try as hard as I could, and things started working for me.
You took 27 shots. That's your second most shot attempts ever in your 105 career postseason games. They always call you unselfish, man. That sounds like ball hog to me.
That's what I was trying to do. No, you know what? I just want to be assertive. That's what it was all about. Pop talked about go out there and shoot the ball 30 times. I wanted to be aggressive for my teammates. I wanted when they were looking at me and saying, "Hey, what are you gonna do for me?" And there were times in there when I wasn't doing anything. I was hurting the team, but got a shot to fall, got two shots to fall, and then things started happening, and then I was able to draw some double teams and get some guys some open shots, and that's what it's all about.
Third time you've hoisted that thing. How does it compare to the first two times?
Because it's here and now, and because of so many other reasons, this is probably the best one, the best feeling I've had in a championship to this point. We worked so hard for it. We just came so far. We had the ups and the downs. We had the injuries. We had so many things to deal with, and it just feels so good to be here right now.
All right, real quickly, Misan that fam was sweet. It's a Virgin Island thing. It means.
Everything's good. Everything's nice.
Nissan, that farm was sweet.
That farm was sweet.
Yo, for those knuckleheads doubting Tim Duncan's legacy before the game, peep this. He joins the following group as the only players to win three or more NBA Finals MVP awards. Shaq won three straight as the Lakers pulled off a three-peat from 2000 to 2002. Shaq was the second player in history to win three straight. Joining Michael Jordan, who pulled it off twice, he was Finals MVP from 91 to 93 and from 96 to 98. And the only other three-time winner of the NBA Finals MVP award, Magic Johnson. Magic won it 1980, 1982, and 1987. You saw me interviewing Tim Duncan. I'm fast. I'm not that fast. I interviewed him right after the game. I didn't just run back up here. Tim, what's the most underrated part of Tim Duncan's game?
I would probably say his decision making. I think this is a guy that really never forces the issue. Tonight, that was a critical component because this guy finally started to get a rhythm offensively, and for the first time in this series, you know, he had to force extra defenders to come, enabled him to find shooters at a critical part of the game. They stepped up, made the plays, but Tim Duncan's ability to beat guys one-on-one early in the game set this up. These are great passes, guys stepping up, making plays when you have to have them. Tim Duncan orchestrated the entire offense from that low post.
I was doing an ESPN.com internet chat the other day, and someone said, hey, there's no way that you'd put Tim Duncan in the same class as Charles Barkley and Karl Malone, would you? I said, yeah. Why do people doubt his legacy?
You know, and I've said this before, and I'll say it again, Tim Duncan is the greatest power forward that has ever played the game. This guy has won three Finals MVPs. He's a two-time MVP winner in the regular season. He's led this team to a championship without the help of another Hall of Fame Famer in David Robinson. So I think that's going to firmly entrench his legacy. As just said, that's how great this guy is. Remember, he dominates both ends of the floor. He's not just the guy who puts up offensive numbers. He impacts it at both ends. That's why even when he doesn't shoot it well, he can still help a team win basketball games.
All this for a guy who, when he was a little kid, was a world-class swimmer as a little kid. Virgin Island thing, a whole international flair. Tony Parker from Friends. Tony had a whole lot of his peeps at Game 7 checking him out.
And they were the defending champs. Now they're the former champs. What is in the Pistons' future now that the title is in their past?
Welcome back to SportsCenter's coverage of the NBA Finals. Game 7 was in San Antonio, but at the Palace at Auburn Hills, fans watched the game on the jumbo screen and did not like what they saw. Still, though, you could use the word resilient and describe the Detroit Pistons. Under Larry Brown, they had won 5 straight games when facing elimination. Before Game 7, I said, yo, Big Ben Wallace, how do you all bounce back like that? He said, it's just what we do. Lindsey Hunter said, everybody's surprised. We've always done this. But as Rachel Nichols reports, they couldn't do it in Game 7.
After nearly 8 months, 427 quarters, more than 5,000 minutes of basketball, the Pistons saw their entire season come down to this. Score tied at 57, 12 minutes to win or lose it all. Not the time for Chauncey Billups and Rip Hamilton to combine for 3 baskets, or for a team built on defense to let Manu Ginobili squeeze his way to the basket.
It was stretches there in the fourth quarter, but we didn't run any plays or anything. We just came down and tried to make something happen, which obviously is not in our best interest, and, you know, that's it.
There were a couple of bad possessions. We took a quick 3. We didn't need to.
We didn't make plays down the stretch, you know, when we really needed to in the crucial points of the game.
But we had our chances. You got to, you know, I thought Pop did a great job of getting us out of stuff with their defensive effort.
As the quarter ground on and the game slipped away, the Pistons realized, in 12 minutes, they cost themselves the opportunity to repeat as champions.
We let one slip away. Everybody feel like we let one slip away.
To be on the road, you know, and lose at the end, a tough, hard-fought game. I'm proud of my guys. You know, I'm proud of the heart that we showed. But, of course, you know, we're disappointed. You know, we feel like, you know, we should be celebrating tonight.
One of the most emotional men coming off the floor Thursday was Larry Brown, who has said doctor's visits in the coming weeks will determine whether he needs to step down as Detroit's coach. He's hurting a lot, said Greg Popovich, who said he felt weird when he met with Brown quietly after the game. Still, Pop said, all Brown tried to do was make me feel better. With the Pistons, I'm Rachel Nichols, ESPN.
Rachel, thanks a lot. If you are curious about what's going to happen to the Detroit Pistons, there are no free agents among them. Everybody is signed through at least next year. Richard Hamilton signed through 2010. They have what they need intact. But guys, after winning a championship last year and coming one game short this year, what do they need to maybe get back again and win it next year?
Well, I think one of the first things they're going to have to do is, I think, add another guard. I think Lindsey Hunter is solid, but I think you want to have somebody who can do something for you on the offensive end, and then and maybe try to get another frontline player. Look, the core is going to be solid, and I think you also have to remember in Antonio McDyess, this is a guy who hadn't played the last couple years, so he's going to have an opportunity in this role to be even more comfortable. You'll see what you saw in the finals, I think, more through the regular season.
Well, depending on what happens with Larry Brown, the first thing might be a coach. After they find a coach, when you look at their from the roster standpoint, I agree with Greg. I think a backup point guard would be something this team could use, especially one with size would be nice. I also think they could use a little bit more perimeter shooting on the wing position if they can get that. These things don't grow on trees, but if you're just looking at them from an X's and O's standpoint, they need that, I think, to shore up their bench a little bit.
Tell you what, Chauncey Billups had a rough Game 7, but you got to give him a shout out. Chauncey Billups is a straight up man. He's a point guard. Protect the ball, don't turn it over. The last 5 games in this series, Chauncey Billups, 35 assists, just 4 turnovers. Ridiculous great play.
Well, Barry Bonds' immediate future may still be in question. Ahead, though, the one thing that could keep Bonds playing into 2007.
And could there be good news on the north side of Chicago? Wood, woo! Pryor, woo! Healthy, woo! News on them coming up on SportsCenter.
This is amazing.
Perfect.
Check out the view.
G'day. My volleyball team used all the taps. Can I come over and borrow one of yours?
Sure.
Hey, Janet, there's donuts in the conference room.
Great.
Yeah.
Make your ideal trip a reality on Expedia with virtual tours to help you book the right hotel for you.
Expedia.com.
Coors Light, cold hard facts. Brought to you by Rocky Mountain Refreshing Coors Light. Taste the cold.
Never has Jeff Gordon been buried so deep in the standings so late in the season ahead. Why the 24 teams not ready to push the panic button just yet. And for the first time in 11 years, it took 7 games to crown a champion. Still ahead, a look back on how the Spurs and Pistons got to this point in the finals.
Welcome back to SportsCenter's coverage of the NBA Finals. They got clocked in the head by 31 points in Game 4. They gave up 90 or more points 4 straight games, but as Shelly Smith reports, the Spurs still found a way to win the NBA championship.
It was hardly Tim Duncan's best shooting night. 10 for 27 does not an MVP make. What did were crisp passes out of a collapsing defense, defensive stops, and a wicked dive for a loose ball.
That just energizes other guys because all it takes is one. It's like the domino effect. Somebody starts and another's finish it off.
It's contagious. He's, you know, he's one of the best players in the world, but he's not the most emotional guy. But when you see him doing that, it's just like the whole team pumps up and start feeling even better.
That's Tim. You know, he's a big fundamental. You know, he's a catalyst to this team. How he plays is how we play.
I felt the game was going bad for me. Yeah, I did feel that. But it was about just kind of pushing through and just the perseverance.
And when Detroit's big man had to sit because of foul trouble, Duncan found his shot.
I got in a roll there for a little while. My shot felt good. Things started going down for me, and I just tried to be aggressive in that point in time.
From the very first possession where he drove to the hole and got his banker, you know, we would say, oh, Tim is ready to play. We're going to ride him and win this thing.
Before Game 7, Robert Horry said Tim Duncan was the third best big man he has played with, behind Hakeem Olajuwon and Shaquille O'Neal. After the game, asked if he wanted to change the order, Horry said no, and here's the reason why. Dream got me 2, Shaq got me 3. If Tim gets me another one next year, ask me again. With the Spurs, I'm Shelly Smith, ESPN.
Shelly, thanks a lot. The San Antonio Spurs legacy, how about third title in the last 7 years? Remember back in the days of David Robinson, he's gone, they're still winning. Tim Duncan, since they drafted him, the Spurs, the highest winning percentage in sports since drafting Duncan out of Wake Forest. And Greg Popovich, a guy they call Pop, the 5th NBA coach to win 3 titles. He beat his best friend to get his 3rd. Tim, what do you think the legacy of the San Antonio Spurs is going to be compared to other teams that have won multiple titles?
You know the scary part? We don't know, because this thing's going to continue for a while, but when it's all said and done, this is certainly going to go down as one of the most dominant decades for a team in NBA history, without question. When I compare it to, say, what the Los Angeles Lakers did winning 3 in a row, I think this is far greater and far more dominant accomplishment.
Better than winning 3
in a
row?
Absolutely, because we've done it over 7 years, and this could continue over the next 8, 9, 10, 11 years with this team, maybe winning 4 or 5 championships in that time. To be that good for that long, over that long of a span, I think it's a greater accomplishment than winning 3 straight. Then you're out, you're done, it's blown up.
That's mind-boggling.
Not to me, it's not.
To win 3 championships in a row is one of the greatest accomplishments anybody can ever accomplish. Now, winning 3 over 7 is great, but to win 3 in a row is, you cannot compare the two.
I think
no way that you can compare the two. But what I will say in terms of this, to me, look, this is a great basketball team. There's no question about it. Tim Duncan is as dominant a power forward, as I've said, as we've ever seen. But to win 3 championships in a row, you know how difficult it is to get to 3 championships in a row. To win 3 in a row, you cannot ever say that something like that is more difficult, winning 3 over 7.
When you have arguably 2, certainly 2 of the top 5 players in the league, you do it for 3 years. Nothing before
so basically
that.
what they did is better than what Bulls did when they won three in a row.
Nothing before it, nothing after it. Okay? And it's going to be a long time before the Los Angeles Lakers are going to compete for a championship.
But we're talking about that team,
and
though.
This team is going to be good. They've done it for over a 7-year
period. First of all,
they've been at the top of the league.
That's great.
Every
they're
year,
a great team.
And they're going to continue to do that.
You win 3 championships in a row. to win three in a row, you cannot argue.
And you can't compare that to what the Bulls did.
I will say
you just said it.
The Bulls
just said it's not.
They won six.
But they won three in a row.
That's right. But they won six.
They won three in a row.
They won six in eight.
As Legg said, Tim Duncan and Manu Ginobili, they are wrapped up through 2010. Tony Parker, he's wrapped up to 2011. So even if it's not as good as three straight, and I ain't agreeing with either one of y'all, I'm just stating the facts. I'm just saying we could be here another 3 or 4 years until 2011.
That's why I said it's going to be a while before the chapter, final chapter is written on this organization, this team.
The Spurs.
That's mind-boggling if you would think that.
That's not mind-boggling. It's true. I take longevity.
You should ask guys
give me,
in one
give me longevity.
What they
there's a producer that's
longevity.
Going rap. They do like this. They like rap. They stop. Stop. The Spurs, 51 three-pointers in this series. The Pistons, only 18, easily the biggest three-point differential in NBA Finals history.
It looked like it might be a sweep at the start. Turned out to be a winner-take-all seven-gamer. When we return, one last look at the drama of this NBA Finals.
SportsCenter's Top 10 Plays, brought to you by Juiced, the video game. Build it, race it, put it all on the line.
SportsCenter continuing from San Antonio. Greg Popovich wins the first Game 7 he ever coaches in. Guys, final thoughts on the first seven-game final series in 11 years.
Great series, first of all, and I think it's fitting that it went seven games because you had two teams that I think are mirror images of each other. Best defensive teams in the league, great coaching, extremely unselfish, but in the end, it came down to the fact that San Antonio had that one dominant guy. Tim Duncan was the guy that took over the series. That's what I'll remember from the series, what he did in Game 7.
Well, I think what it was for me, if you go back to last year with the Lakers, they had that dominant guy, but they weren't a cohesive unit. This San Antonio Spurs team was a cohesive unit. Their chemistry was a whole lot better. They understood how they won, and you saw in Game 7, Tim Duncan was the guy they went to consistently. That's what allowed them to be crowned world champions.
First four games, winning margin of 15-plus points. First time that's ever happened. Last three games, nobody ever had a double-digit lead. The sights and sounds of the seven-game NBA Finals won by the Spurs.
Welcome to the 2005 NBA Finals, where legends are born. Ginobili is everywhere.
Detroit has clearly been outplayed. The Pistons are in deep trouble.
We'll be happy to get back to Detroit.
Detroit's playing harder, smarter, faster.
It's a three-game series now.
Robert Ory! Wow. Just clutch shot after clutch shot. And here we go from San Antonio.
We could fight any odds. A lot of people thought he's going to be out tonight.
It's the last game.
You win it all, or you go back home with nothing.
Two teams, one game for the championship. Ginobili, the two on the clock, huge. The San Antonio Spurs are the NBA champions.